And so we've come to the moment of truth, the 15th stage, the individual time trial. The rider's moving down to Trieste now, which is over towards the borders of the old Yugoslavia. And it is there now where the rider will face up to a 40 kilometres time trial, 25 miles. There's a climb which takes them up to the 11.5 kilometre point, and then it gently rolls off the hill down to the flat finish. It's a beautiful day. All we want now is to see how the stars in the first big test will come out of it. This is the situation. Pantani now 22 seconds. That's all behind the new leader, Zulla. Tonkov, the ever-present Tonkov, is third. Guerini, because of that ride, is up into fourth. And, you know, you mustn't underrate Guerini. He's a good rider in the Giro d'Italia. Well, this is the start, Paul, of Pavel Tonkov.
It's the first chance we've seen of these magnificent bicycles, and out there on the course, this is the Blade, the bicycle that was in fact designed for Miguel Indurain several years ago. L'Espada, they called it in Spanish, and this is the chance a lot of riders have to try and prove themselves to be in good form. But in the early part of the race, a lot of riders finding the 40 kilometres, 25 miles, very difficult indeed. But the latter starters, men like Marco Pantani, realised that it's so important for him to try and do something special. But out on the course, coming in with the fastest time, is a man who always puts a good time in the time trials. Sergei Gonchar comes to the line with a new best time of 45 minutes and 31 seconds.
Well, that's going to be the marker. Even Pantani may not, and I would say should not, get towards that time. Gonchar shot to the fore last year in the Giro d'Italia with a great time trial. He went on to become a medalist in the World Time Trial Championship. Now he's in with the best time for the 40 kilometres. Back to Tonkov.
Well, Tonkov, a man capable of putting in a very good time trial, but the man I think who must certainly be one of the big favourites for this stage has to be Alex Zulla. He'll be starting in last position, and that will give him the advantage of knowing what the intermediary times are of all the other riders. And here he is coming off the starting ramp right now, resplendent in the pink jersey and on a very fast time trial machine. And right in front of him on the road is going to be Pavel Tonkov.
Well, big Alex knows what it's like to be a world champion of the time trial. And now we're looking at the big boys all out on the course, separated only by their start time here. And remember, Gonchar is in with the best time, and that's a marker. Here comes Michele Bartoli, not surprisingly, slipping down. This is a partway check here, Paul. Plus 36 seconds, so he's fourth at partway. That's a pretty good performance by Bartoli.
It certainly is, but it's the early part of the course when you have to get into your rhythm straight away, and Alex Zulla looks very comfortable on this early climb. As you said, it takes them up to 11.5 kilometres, and then it's 30 kilometres down to the finish. Here's an intermediary check, though, for Andrea Noah, the early leader. He goes through in fourth place, almost 1.25 minutes off the mark.
Well, Zulla is riding very strongly. The checks are indicating he is nibbling a short lead here. Gonchar is the leader, who's won the time trial stage for the past 2 years, don't forget. Tonkov, 1.4 seconds down, Paul. That's not a lot as we see the arrival of Belli.
Well, Belli thinking more about the days to come and the work he's going to have to do for the overall leader, Alex Zulla. He comes through in 20th place, 2 minutes 45 seconds off the leaderboard. But Marco Pantani is coming up to the intermediary point there. We get a chance to see just how well Pantani is riding in a discipline that he normally doesn't like very much.
So Pantani a little bit off the pace here. It's 11th place and losing ground. All these riders are pretty hot time trial riders. Pantani, don't forget, may have used a lot of energy yesterday to that mountain top finish. He's going through 17th at the moment, over 73 seconds down on Gonchar, who has finished. Huge crowds here now waiting to see what Alex Zulla can do, as he will head up now towards that same checkpoint. At the moment, though, it is Gonchar, Tonkov and Carlos Dominguez, by the way, who's third best.
Look at this, Zulla still inside the time of Sergei Gonchar, a winner last year of a time trial stage in the Tour of Italy. And this is the terrain that Alex Zulla really can excel in, the time trial. He's a specialist at that, he's been the world champion, and he's well inside the time set by Gonchar early on at this intermediary point at half distance.
Well, Gonchar, remember, lost the world title to Laurent Jalabert last year. And look at that, he's gone 36 seconds to the good. So Zulla is riding a superb time trial. And if he keeps this up with the toughest part behind him, he's going to increase his overall lead over the others. We're looking again at Tonkov. He was second on the road, he's now third.
Powerful rider. Oscar Kamenzin, the champion of Switzerland, coming up to the line as well. A great performance by him going across in fifth place, but 1 minute 38 seconds off the leader. But out on the course, I have to tell you, Phil, Alex Zulla looking very good. Another good performance coming in. Michele Bartoli, second for him.
Wow, in fact, third as he slips up, 1 minute, 18 seconds down. Look at the speed of here of Tonkov, 56.7 kilometres an hour. You know, if Zuller is going quicker, then we are on to see the fastest ever time trial in the history of the Giro d'Italia.
And looking there at the figure of Marco Pantani a little further down the road, in fact, you will see the pink jersey on the shoulders of Alex Zuller, who started 2 minutes behind him in this time trial, and now he's got the fantastic sight of having the leader of the King of the Mountains right in front of him. And that will spur him on, because that means he will at least get a two-minute advantage over the little climber from Pantani.
Well, the roads are nice and wide, they're very flat, the sun is up in the sky, it's a warm day, and Pavel Tonkov should be second best when he gets the line. Andre Noah comes in 21st for him, so his race will continue, and the capture here of Pantani by Zuller, and he flies by him. This is an incredible piece of performance here, Alex Zuller cutting up a path towards victory in the Giro d'Italia, even with the mountains that are still to come.
Incredible speed by Alex Zuller there, and I think Marco Pantani will be reasonably happy to the fact that he's only lost 2 minutes so far on a man at the specialist at this kind of event, Alex Zuller. Zuller flying along here well in excess of 55 kilometres an hour, looking very calm and collected and in control of the situation, and all Pantani can do now is try and keep the flying Swiss rider in his sights.
The face of Pavel Tonkov, the winner of this tour 2 years ago, Gotti now out of it and no chance of repeating his victory of last year. Tonkov, the obvious candidate. The best time in is Sergei Gonchar. Tonkov is coming in, he's behind Gonchar, and he's going to slot in third place at the moment. He won't be too happy with that.
Marco Pantani still can see the shadow in front of him of the pink jersey, Alex Zuller, a big armada of machines right behind him. The advantage now of Zuller around about 250 metres, but Zuller really pushing as much as he can into that big chainring he's got on the front there. 56 tooth on the front chainring, and I would think his smallest sprocket at the back is going to be around about 11, so that will be an incredibly big gear that he's just making mincemeat out of.
Well, Zuller will now be the next rider to finish in the overall classification as he continues now. Tonkov is in, he's caught Pantani. Pantani's going to keep him in his sights at all costs. But even so, Zuller has pulled away. There's the time of Gonchar, and there is the time of Alex Zuller. Tonkov now comes on the screen. I think there's something actually wrong with the timings here. 45:38 for Alex Zuller. I actually think that is wrong. And Zuller has produced the best time of the day, and we'll get confirmation of that, I'm sure. The scream is wrong. I think they were wrong when they put Tonkov's time up. They're slightly out of sync, I think. That's out of our control, as now the arrival of Marco Pantani heading up towards the finish. And in fact, Alex Zuller has been declared the winner. His time amended, so we're not sure what Pantani's doing now, but they're giving him 24th place at the moment. The time of Alex Zuller, and there it is amended, 44:38. That is a record average speed for any of the Giro d'Italia time trials. The previous best, by the way, was Yevgeny Berzin a few years ago. So Zuller beats Gonchar and Tonkov, and Carlos Dominguez is the other rider. So Alex Zuller has increased his overall lead in the Giro d'Italia in 2 days of excellent racing, but of course with the Dolomites still to come, and therefore you can never count out Marco Pantani, who may be the leader of the King of the Mountains, but he really does want to win the Giro d'Italia. And what about Pavel Tonkov, Paul, because he's a man who is really looking good.
But going into the last week of this Giro, Phil, I have to tell you one thing. Alex Zuller is looking very confident indeed. Tactically, he's ridden perfectly, but certainly he's put a lot of effort into that first 10 days of this race, and I feel that he may well pay for it a little later on. Tonkov certainly looking like a possible future winner.
And almost 68 hours in the saddle now for the race leader, Alex Zuller. The others that little bit slower. Pavel Tonkov lying second. Marco Pantani is third. And a little bit uphill today towards the end as the riders move away on the 16th stage from Udine to Asiago. Tomorrow, of course, is the day they fear most in the high mountains. And there may be a few rather tired legs today, Paul, especially after that time trial yesterday.
It's always a very strange stage racing after a time trial, because a lot of the big heads of state of the world of cycling tend to push themselves a lot more than the lesser riders. And that's why a day after a time trial like that, you can very often see a breakaway going clear.
Well, seven times so far, the leadership has changed in the Giro d'Italia. Alex Zuller has got it back again, defending his lead. That 2 minutes, 2 seconds over Tonkov. And of course, Pantani hovering dangerously so, one has to say, in third place. The riders taking a gentle ride out here now as they head out towards the start of the race. The weather is good, the sun is high in the sky, and I think one or two riders will hope today to have a fairly easy ride down to the finishing line, because the Marmolada is the big mountain tomorrow, and that will be an absolute brute. And there's the fly past of the Italian jets going over the top, much to the amusement of Oscar Camusin. They don't have many aeroplanes left in the Swiss Air Force.
Well, this is the first time, Phil, we've actually seen a stage like this, which I think is why the riders are enjoying the flypast of the Tricolore of Italy there, because really we've seen very fast stages so far, and I think they're all quite happy to cruise along the airstrip here and just enjoy the sights.
Well, there's the Italian colour. I think it's just a sign of anger. The pilots want to land, and the Giro d'Italia is on the runway here as the riders now make their way out to the start. The pink jersey, even Alex Zulla, is being amused by the situation. But that's not the way it's going to stay. The race now underway, and the riders heading another long stage, this over 230 kilometres down towards the finish.
And once the victory can be smelt on the nostrils of these riders, they go out and really put the pressure on. And once again, you can see the big long line here of a breakaway that's got clear. They've managed to steal away from the rest of the big heads of state of this year's Giro d'Italia, because everybody realizes that a lot of the big men in this race will be thinking about the big mountain stage tomorrow.
Well, throughout the day, none of the top riders have been involved in the big moves. And so there's a breakaway gone, and nobody really affecting the break. There's the escape gap, 16 plus minutes. People like Piccolini are in here, Bettini's in here, Ferrigato, Fontanelli, Nicola Loda, good finisher there. Klaus Møller is even here from Denmark. He's on the TVM team, by the way. But nobody really, well, there's somebody launched an attack, but nobody affecting the overall classification.
Well, this group is 1 minute 13 seconds behind that leading group of riders, and they were originally part of that leading group, but it's just split to pieces for the moment, and everybody scrambling to try and survive on this very tough stage.
Well, Fontanelli here is trying to get away. And what might be worth remembering, Paul, that Fabio Fontanelli won the 16th stage of the Giro d'Italia last year, and this is stage 16 now. And he's at the head of this rather large group of riders, and he's trying to reduce the size of it. A little bit of a problem for the Kelmy rider out on the course. This is Ochoa Palacios, well, his 23-year-old Spanish rider on the Kelmy team, trying to ride away from the group now. And chasing him here, number 22, is Paolo Bettini. He's had his lead in the King of the Mountains. Here's where the attack came, Bettini with him. Bettini's still scoring a few points in the King of the Mountains.
Well, in fact, he's lost the lead in that competition to Marco Pantani, and I don't think anybody can say that Marco Pantani doesn't deserve to be the leader of the King of the Mountains. And there you can see the gap that they have over the group containing the leader of the race, Alex Zulla, 15 minutes and 40 seconds.
Well, these are the boys enjoying today's stage of the Giro, while the top boys are having a little bit of a rest here. Fontanelli's number 106. They're still throwing in the weight behind this breakaway, but the top riders languishing 16 minutes behind, of course, remembering that tomorrow brings in the climb of the Fedaya Marmolada, which comes at 175 kilometres, a first category climb.
And after that, the Cima Coppi, the highest point of the Giro d'Italia, at over 2,000 metres. So a very tough day in store for everybody on tomorrow's stage, which is why these riders who expect to just try and finish tomorrow's stage are out pushing themselves to the limit. Mario Cipollini there, happy to ride very close to the front of the group. He won't be looking for the stage victory today, because still the advantage of that leading group of riders well up on a quarter of an hour.
Well, at least Mario's still in the Giro d'Italia at this stage of the race. Sometimes he's given up by now. This is the composition of the breakaway. All the Italian flags there, except Klaus Møller of Denmark, breaking up the sequence. And this break knows that they're going to succeed today. It's a question of just planning which one of them is going to win.
Look at that speed. You can see just how tough this final few kilometres is. 27 kilometres an hour. That's just a shade under 18 miles an hour. So certainly this has been a very tough final 50 kilometres to the stage. And we've climbed up to around about 1,000 metres. We're on a plateau at the moment, and there's no flat section at all now on this course as we head down towards the finish line.
Well, there's nine riders in the breakaway, and we should have seen the Spanish flag on that caption as well, because there is one rider from Spain here, one from Denmark, and the rest from Italy.
And Bettini's gone again. He wants to get out of this group of nine riders because he realises that's the best chance he's got of getting a stage victory if he can do it alone. But nobody, after this long breakaway where they've all been together working very well to build up that magic lead of almost a quarter of an hour now, have been working well together. Nobody shirked at all from the work that's necessary to make a success of a group like this.
Well, the rider sitting right off the front of the group there is Cassani from the Polti team. And just coming up behind him there, it looks as though we've got Mariano Piccoli. Oh, the Spanish flag is at the bottom. I might have missed it last time. I don't think it was there. But anyway, it is now. And this is the breakaway. There's a lot of cat and mouse going on here because there's so much time in hand over the field. And none are in contention for the Maglia Rosa. But they're all in contention, of course, for the win with 15 kilometres to go. We're onto a sort of plateau now with a few ripples that will take the riders over to the finish.
Well, Alex Zulla seems very happy there in the pink jersey with the way the race has evolved today. Give him a chance to just recuperate a little bit from the effort he put in yesterday to win that time trial and extend his lead in the overall standings. But at the front, it really is no holds barred here because everybody is trying to get off the front and win this stage as we head into the town now of Asiago.
Just a little split in the field here. The Kelme rider sitting at the back of the group. Moller is still here, the Danish rider. But there's a little bit of a scampering away from the front of the group here now. As they go, we've got Bettini, Scirea, Mario Scirea is here, the Seiko rider. There he is on the front, the big Seiko man. And Fontanelli is the little rider tucked in at the back. Remember, to the very stage a year ago, he was the winner, and he looks as though he's getting himself into a nice position. This is Paolo Bettini.
Bettini looks very nervous. He doesn't want the other group of the riders behind to come back up to them here. He feels more at an advantage just having two men to watch. But in the main field, no real chase there being organised at all as we look here at Fontanelli, keeping the pressure on, making sure that the six riders behind don't come back, because he too is a very good finisher, a winner last year of two stages of the Tour of Langkawi. And at the moment, just keeping an eye over his shoulder to see what the advantage is over that group behind.
Mario Scirea not willing to offer more than he has to the breakaway. Fontanelli, a crafty rider, taking a look at Paolo Bettini. And it's 1 kilometre from the line now. Bettini really doesn't want to be number one anymore. He wants to slip behind them, and the other two, of course, are having none of it. Three Italians in at the last shout.
Well, the big man on the back there wearing number 9, Mario Scirea, normally a lead-out man for Mario Cipollini. He's the kind of guy who should wind the sprint up from a long way out, 800 metres to go, looking over his shoulder, and in fact, it's Bettini the first to move.
Well, he's gone very, very early. I think he's seen the left-hander in front, but he's eased right back again, and Fontanelli's come back into the lead now. Fontanelli can see the front of the race now, and he's going to give everything, but he's now... Bettini has got it first, gritting his teeth and going for it. Fontanelli has got Bettini's wheel, and looks though the big Scirea isn't going to get in on the act here, but can Fontanelli get off the back wheel of Bettini? And I think he can. Stage 16, 2 years in a row. Fabio Fontanelli gets the stage at 25 miles an hour, the average speed today. Nothing to write home about. Flashing over the line there in fourth place is Mario Piccoli. So he keeps getting points in that competition. Ferragato fifth, Loda sixth, and Cassani seventh. None of the men that matter on the result, Paul, because they're still coming in.
They're still a long way behind. A good day for Alex Zulla, nothing to worry about, nothing to write home about either. Putting his team, Festina, on the front to control affairs, thinking about the tactics for tomorrow. But a great move by Fontanelli, perfectly timed here. Bettini panicked a little bit, let it out, and Fontanelli was in an ideal position just to come off his shoulder and get himself the second win on stage 16 2 years in a row.
But in the end, of course, Alex Zulla coming in this back group will keep his pink jersey on the eve of the toughest stage, that's what they're saying, of this year's Giro d'Italia. Certainly a stage which crosses the highest mountains. So we come to the stage they've talked about long ago, even when the tour route was announced, 17th stage from Asiago to Selva di Valgardena. 200 plus kilometres. This is the overall situation as we go into the mountains today. Tonkoff looking for 202. Bettini is third. Pantani is down to fourth. Well, I say down to fourth, but he's been a challenger throughout this race. There's his team. And Paul, he knows today has to be his day.
A very difficult stage, and all the mountains really packed in the second half of the course. 100 kilometres from the finish is when all the big climbs start, and already riders out there trying to toughen it up. Riders who feel that they've got a chance of stealing an advantage over the big climbers. We're looking here at one of the riders on the new team. This is Buenahora, riding for Vitalico Seguros from Spain, a man who's always ridden well here in the Tour of Italy and the Tour de France. A great climber, but certainly the hammer will come down behind, Phil, because we have got the Passo di Marmolada, the ride, the climb that many of these riders fear, and almost straight after that, the Passo di Sella, which this year is the Cima Coppi, the highest point of the Giro d'Italia, 2,200 metres.
And the other two riders here, Kepi Gonzalez and Oscar Camazin, they're the early pacemakers. An interesting move that Tonkoff has told Camazin to start trying and drawing the string early on these riders. But the news at the start this morning, Ivan Gotti not among the starters. He says his form just isn't there, it's not a shadow of what it was last year, and he still complains of stomach sickness.
He certainly hasn't managed to get the form back that brought him the victory in the Tour of Italy last year, and he suffered all through the season. And now they're suffering a lot today as well. Paolo Bettini, the man who was out on the attack yesterday, and that group, which was around about 140 riders on the start line this morning, is down to a very select group of 30 riders. And Alex Zuller in the pink jersey there, looking very comfortable at the front of the main group.
Well, our climbs today going over 2,200 metres, and so that's some in the region of 7,000 plus feet. And the riders know they have a real tough day, and decision time is here. Dmitry Konyshev in the centre of our picture, the rider who was the first Russian rider, well, the first Soviet Union rider to pull on the King of the Mountains leader's jersey in the Tour de France. Tonkoff decides to lift the pace a little bit. The first test, perhaps.
Tonkoff, very strong rider. He's definitely not a pure climber, but he climbs with power. Second in the overall standings, 2 minutes and 2 seconds behind Alex Zuller. And obviously the team to react is going to be Festina. They're not going to let Pavel Tonkoff ride away like that. But in that group, one man missing from the front of that group, in fact, Phil, was Marco Pantani, not riding up towards the front with the other big leaders.
Well, you know, he's going to have to go early if he does anything at all on this stage. He doesn't finish up a mountain, which is not really his favourite. It finishes almost downhill, in fact. And here's Pantani now, who climbed his way through with his usual rhythm. Fourth overall, 3 minutes 48. It's a big task to bridge 3:48 to a man like Alex Zuller. As he makes his way up now to the back wheel of Tonkoff, and right behind him there is Giuseppe Guerini, who finished third overall last year in the Giro.
Amazing the ease with which Marco Pantani rides up and down these groups in the mountains. One minute he's sitting right at the back, and when he feels there's a certain amount of danger, he just cruises up right round the outside and puts himself into an ideal position to keep an eye on what's going on. But it looks as if Alex Zuller is suffering a little bit, because he's not quite on the wheel of the rider in front of him. But this is a chance to see the big power of Pavel Tonkoff.
Well, Zuller said last night he's not sure he will still lead the Tour by the end of tomorrow, and that's now today, as indeed Pantani has started that relentless rhythm again to see how many riders he can break.
Pantani loves climbing. Once he's got a chance of getting to the front of a small group like this, he just puts the pressure on and accelerates to see who can follow the incredible changes of speed that he's got on these big mountain slopes, looking very concentrated at the moment. There's still a breakaway up the road of three riders, and one of those is Camazin, which is a very good tactical move, really, by the Mapei squad, because if Tonkoff can get up to Camazin, then the Mapei squad is going to have the advantage of numbers. But look at this. You can't see the pink jersey of Alex Zuller following the pace.
Well, if you're not feeling good, there he is down there, Paul, and if you're not feeling good, today is not the day to wear the pink jersey. He knows that Pantani is moving clear with Gotti, and with Tonkoff, of course, and with Guerini. Here they are, and Tonkoff still making good pacemaking here, but this group is moving clear on the Marmolada. They're picking up the stragglers now of the early breakaways, and they're not going to stay with them at all. They're going to drop back.
But Pantani looks across at the rider he's just passed there, looking over to see where Alex Zuller is, and Zuller is a long way down the road at the moment, suffering to get his condition, suffering to get into any kind of rhythm to control the pace that's being set currently by Marco Pantani. And Pantani, it always amazes me, Phil, to see him on the slopes of these climbs. It just looks so easy when he gets out of the saddle. Those legs of his just flow around, a very fluid motion.
Well, here comes little Kepi Gonzalez, who's a real great climber. And these are the last two survivors up front now, Paul, and looking here on the face of the Vitalico rider, he's not feeling too happy at all.
The two Colombians at the head of affairs now, Buenahora and Kepi Gonzalez, they know each other very well indeed, and certainly they will be getting information of what is happening behind, and the big reaction is coming from Marco Pantani, who needs, if he wants to climb further up the overall standings, to put a lot of time between himself and men like Tonkov and Alex Zulla.
Just look at the massive crowd here on the mid-slopes of the Marmolada, going as far as the eye can see up to what is the snow line to date, and they're going to be given the usual treatment by Pantani. They'll see Il Parato in action, and they're picking up one by one the riders of that breakaway and dispatching them back towards the peloton. And very soon, Pantani and Ghirini, and I'm not too sure what's happened to Tonkov, but I'm presuming he's been dropped, they're going to make their way forward.
Pantani just sits there you can see now. In fact, Tonkov has been joined by Alex Zulla. So Zulla riding himself into some form of rhythm on this climb here, but in great difficulty trying to match any of the pace that has been set by Marco Pantani on the early slopes of this climb.
Well, it's a time for Pantani to get his own back on Zulla after that time trial when Zulla came flying by him at clearly almost a third quicker than he was going. Now we're on the mountain, and now Pantani can hurt Zulla here. But Zulla is a clever rider. He's not a man to panic. He's never one to say he can ride alongside Pantani. The thing is to find your own rhythm and climb this mountain at your speed. And with the strength and the talent of Zulla, he should be able to ride past the majority of the riders.
Well, the man doing the job at the moment is 141 Giuseppe Ghirini, who's still managing to stay in the slipstream of Marco Pantani. But I tell you one thing, the crowd certainly love this man. They're going crazy. They want Pantani to walk away with the Tour of Italy today. And he certainly is putting a lot of his adversaries into difficulties on the slopes of this climb, the Marmolada.
Well, you know, Ghirini had a great tour last year. He took over the job of team leader after Luc Leblanc slammed into that wall in the time trial and eventually retired from the race when he was right up there on a podium finish, and he came up to finish in third place and get a podium place. So he's a very good rider, Ghirini, and once you've proved that you can do it, then very often you come back and you repeat the feat. And right now, he knows if he controls Marco Pantani and goes with Marco Pantani, you can see the gaps that Pantani is opening, and then Ghirini can start dreaming of a high podium place again.
1 kilometer to go to the summit of the Col de Marmolada. That is Kepi Gonzalez still with a 1:45 advantage over the chasers, and not even a worry on the thought of Marco Pantani here. He's just trying to set the pace as much as he can to make sure that he can open up as much advantage on the guys behind him. He's not worried about Kepi Gonzalez. Gonzalez here thinking more about the possibility of getting over the top of this climb and keeping his advantage on the way towards the finish line.
Well, there's this beautiful climb here, the Marmolada, that all of the riders fear, except, of course, if your name is Marco Pantani. And Kepi Gonzalez climbing very, very well here. And he's the last survivor of the breakaway now, and he's being chased by all of the top riders.
Look at this, 13% of really steep climb when you bear in mind that they've been climbing this climb for 22 kilometers so far, and you can see the snow line at the top, and Alex Zulla looking across the corners to see if he can see what kind of disadvantage he's got over the leaders on the road and see if he can just see the shape of Marco Pantani on one of the higher climbs up this mountain, because he knows now that he really has to put himself into difficulty to try and make sure he can keep the pink jersey on his shoulders as Kepi Gonzalez now here approaches the summit of this very difficult climb, the Passo di Fidea Marmolada.
And the Tifosi enjoying their day. One rider who has been dropped and is reported to be right down at the end of the field is Michele Bartoli. Another man who has abandoned the race is Mario Cipollini, and so he's not getting over the mountains again in this Giro.
Well, that's a big surprise, because I thought Mario Cipollini was looking very comfortable over the last couple of days, but certainly he wasn't too happy when the rain and the cold weather came down on this year's Tour of Italy. As we come to the top of the climb, we get a chance now to see what sort of deficit Marco Pantani has over the leader, Kepi Gonzalez, and it's 1:19 over the summit of that climb, and there's still, Phil, an awful long way to go to the finish. It's around about 30 k's from the finish line.
Well, hats off to Alex Zulla, the way he's riding here at the moment, because he looks to me, Paul, as though he's actually finding his rhythm again, even though the gap is opening and that pink jersey could now be transferring across to Marco Pantani. But even if that is to be the case, with the time trial still to come, Zulla could take that jersey back for a fourth time.
What he has to do now is to make sure that he doesn't panic, to keep riding sensibly well within his limit, so on the flatter part of the course, he can actually recover and pull a bit of time back. But there is 3 minutes and 8 seconds behind the leader, so that puts him around about 2 minutes behind Marco Pantani.
Well, fine piece of tempo by Zulla, and hats off to him in that case. The rider still there riding with him is Leonardo Pipoli, who is another great climber, and really the man on the Seiko team now, because the stars have gone, Cipollini and Gotti.
Well, really, they came to this race as the defending champions last year. They had Mario Cipollini take the points classification and Ivan Gotti take the pink jersey all the way up to Milano. And this year, they've really been devastated by the tough climbs here in the mountains. But this is Oscar Kammans in here trying to get across and put himself back up to Kepi Gonzalez. Earlier on, he was with Gonzalez, and he will probably very shortly see the green jersey on the shoulders of Marco Pantani coming up to him.
I'd completely forgotten about Kammans in. We hadn't seen him for a while, but there he is. He's still lying second on the road and still in a very good position to go forward here with this breakaway as they begin to merge.
Well, they've picked up Buenahora, so still two riders in front of them. This is Kepi Gonzalez. A little bit further behind him is going to be Kammans Ind, and then the big group with Marco Pantani, who certainly are eating up the road now as they attempt the first descent here off the Marmolada. They'll be thinking very seriously about the next big climb of the day, the Cima Coppi, the Passo di Sella, which goes up to 2,200 metres.
Well, we'll see how the riders tackle that. The general opinion is the Marmolada is the tougher of the two climbs, but the other one is certainly higher. And we're forming at the front now a group of five riders. Kammans Ind jumps on the back wheel there of the Vitalis Buenahera, it is the Colombian rider, and then Guerini and Pantani.
Well, that'll be somewhat of a shock for Kammans Ind, because he would have expected his own man Tonkoff to be in that group. In fact, Tonkoff was riding very well on the early slopes of this climb, and a lot further back down the main field is Alex Zulla, trying to make sure that he doesn't panic. He's got a very good group with him here now, so they'll all work together and try and limit their losses when they come to the bottom of the very next tough climb.
Well, Pantani is not going to give them a chance now if he can avoid it. He's gone very early. He had to use the climb of the Marmolada. Now he can, if he can increase his climb on the next one. We're passing through the feed station here of Canesi, I think the town is called, as the riders race through. The time gap, I presume now, is on Zulla's group behind Pantani.
This is Tonkoff going through here, 1 minute, 18 seconds right behind the leader, and Zulla a lot further back. You can see now 2 minutes, 19 seconds to Alex Zulla. So the race starting to come back a little bit together, because at one moment, Kepi Gonzalez had an advantage of over 3 minutes, but he hasn't got any advantage now, because the green jersey on the shoulders of the king of the mountains of this year's Giro d'Italia, Marco Pantani, has pulled him back into the fold.
And Pantani still must gain in excess of 1 minute and 20 seconds to get that pink jersey away from Alex Zulla. Zulla is riding a very clever race today. He's not trying to kill himself to hold Pantani. I think he accepts he can't do that, but he can limit his losses and maybe save the day. It's all down to Pantani and how much he can gain.
Pantani hasn't got any friends in this group here. Guerini sitting on his wheel. Two Colombians in there, Buenahora and Kepi Gonzalez. And of course, Oscar Kammans Ind, the champion of Italy, of Switzerland. He's not going to give any help at all to the flying El Pirata.
Not when he's the teammate of Pavel Tonkov, who is still behind. I tell you what, Kammans Ind has been quite a revelation in the race here. Former winner of the Tour of Switzerland and also the national champion of his country. Now beginning to move smoothly into the big time of cycling. I think he's a third-year pro.
Well, there's a problem here with Marco Pantani. In fact, his chain's come off. He looked as if he knew that was going to happen. He slowed down, moved to one side, and very quickly behind the team car, the team mechanic stopped, and he's up away. And I don't think very many people are going to ride away from Marco Pantani on this climb here as he picks his way up through straight past Buenahora.
Who looks as though he's hit the wall the way he was going there. He'd slowed right down, further down the slopes. We've got the pink jersey here, trying to just keep things as they are at the minute. Tonkoff is with him.
Right on his shoulder in the yellow jersey there, the man who won a stage of the Alpe d'Huez as his first ever victory as a professional, Roberto Conti. But up the field, this is a great piece of racing by Marco Pantani. Kepi Gonzalez tried to take advantage of that little mechanical incident, as did Guerini, who was just a little bit around the corner in front of Marco Pantani, but no panic for the Italian.
Talking to Conti there, Paul, he said his first ever victory. I think it's still the only victory he's ever had. Not a bad one to put on your list, though, is it?
Tonkoff. If you're going to win one race in your career, it might as well be the Alpe d'Huez. And certainly Roberto Conti will think about that victory for many years to come. But now he's a great teammate to have for Marco Pantani because he's the kind of rider who is solid whenever it comes to these big three-week races. And Pantani pulling himself very easily back to the front of this race and catching up with Guerini.
So the head of the race as they continue to climb through this beautiful valley here in the South Tyrolean mountains. And Pantani, free as a bird right now. It's all down to him now. He's got rid of the boys. Can he leave them behind? These are the three front runners, Guerini and Kepi Gonzalez. Buenahora hit the wall. I'm a bit surprised about that because he's a good climber, but he's dropped off the pace.
He certainly exploded once they got to the foot of this climb here, the Passo di Sella, and he really disappeared very rapidly indeed. The man trying to pull himself back into the race, not very far behind Marco Pantani on the road, is the man who was the former winner of this event, Pavel Tonkov, riding a sensible pace for him, around about 1 minute in front of Alex Zuller, who has got no friends at all in this group.
Now we cross the road here and move on to the continuation of this climb where it gets a little bit steeper and 20 kilometers to go to the line. Still a long way. That's still a long chance for Pantani to build on his lead. Remember, once we see that lead climb up over 3 minutes 48 seconds over Zuller, then Pantani will literally be in the pink.
Well, he's 1 minute and 30 seconds up on Pavel Tonkov at the moment. This is the Alex Zuller group with two riders from Mapei in there as well. But for Pantani, it's just an escapade for him, riding as hard as he can. He doesn't even think about asking Guerini for any help at all. And Pavel Tonkov riding sensibly. He's now picked up at Buenahora, riding for him what is definitely a very long and lonely road.
Well, if the situation was to stay like this, it would in fact be Tonkov who would take the pink jersey and Pantani would move up into second place. Now, there's more time checks coming our way. 1:41, they're saying now, so they're losing a little bit of ground. And there's the 3:50 mark. Well, that's it. That means Pantani is 2 seconds quicker now on the course over the period of racing we've had over Alex Zuller. So he's out of the pink jersey. It's a question of whether it will go at the moment to Tonkov or to Pantani. And what's the bets for Pantani, the way he's riding?
Unbelievable. You never, though, can discount Pavel Tonkov. He's such a good rider at dosing his effort. He won't panic at all. He'll ride a very sensible course for him. He'll make sure that he doesn't lose too much over the top of this very steep climb, the Passo di Sella. And he'll take a lot of risks on the descent. But the big advantage Marco Pantani has for a rider who is very light indeed, weighing around about 54 kilograms, is that he can go downhill very well.
Well, Pantani getting a little bit of help now from Guerini, because Guerini, I think, will begin to believe in himself here to survive with Marco Pantani over these two steep climbs. Tonkov is not dropping any further back, Paul, and is looking quite good as well.
1 minute, 53 seconds. He started the day 2 minutes and 2 seconds behind Zuller, but in fact, he was only 1 minute and 48 seconds ahead of Marco Pantani. So I would think Marco Pantani now is almost leader on the road, but you cannot discount Pavel Tonkov. He's still got an awful long way to go to the finish. And from the top of the final climb, you'd go downhill very quickly, 15 kilometers the descent off this mountain to the finish line.
Guerini should pick up the advantage then if he hangs on to Pantani all the way over the ripples. And that will certainly lift him back up into the overall leaders as well. And he'd be pretty happy with that.
He certainly will, and once again, as they go over the summit, he's waving the flag for Polti, because last year he finished in this race in third in the overall standings after taking over the leadership from Luc Leblanc, and he's proved to be a very solid rider indeed. And Pavel Tonkov now approaching the summit of the climb. We'll get a chance to see just what sort of damage has been done by Marco Pantani.
Well, Pantani, his team as a team, and also right up on the top of the leaderboard in the team competition. So Pantani trying to bring them the pink jersey as well. As we flip over the top, 2:02 now. To the main man in this group, he's number two behind the leader there, and that is Tonkov. Now, what is Zuller? And it's still counting when the clock stops, because it's certainly going to go. 3:48 is the magic time that will depose him of that yellow jersey, and we haven't quite got there yet as we join the front two on the descent. And I think we'll see some good racing here. Here comes the Zuller group, and oh, goodness me, Paul, it's 4:35 and counting.
Well, Alex Zuller's lost an awful lot of time, but the man doing the great ride is Pavel Tonkov, the former winner. He's ridden sensibly. He's not lost too much time on Marco Pantani. He won't, for the moment, be in the pink jersey, but what is important now is just how much time Marco Pantani can conserve on this descent. And he's the one putting the pressure on, and he's taking a lot of risks going around these corners. But unlike the other day, these roads are very flat. flat and the corners are very, very fast indeed.
Absolutely. What we can see of the descent so far, this is the descender's delight here. Bit of a tight one there, though.
These are the kind of descents that Sean Yates used to adore. You can go down these mountains so fast, and a good descender can pull back 1 or 2 minutes on a descent like this. But you can see now, in fact, Guerini is coming to the front and giving Pantani a certain amount of help here, because he too feels that this ride by Pantani can move him up a little way in the overall standings. And in fact, the team manager of Mercatone Uno coming up alongside Marco Pantani here to give him some information as we approach the finish. But again, look at the speed here, 24 kilometers an hour. It's a tough day.
Well, if the top stars can only do 24 kilometres an hour, goodness knows what the club cyclists would do over this course, because this is a tough day today. And nobody can ever say that Azzurra is a great descender. Look at him line up the back of the group here. He's going to pull back nothing on the way down to the finish at all. Pantani, it's all advantage him, and he's not descending that well either.
Well, Tonkov pulling himself back into the race, 1 minute 49 seconds behind, and the magic figure between Pantani and Tonkov is 1 minute and 48 seconds. So Pantani's going to have to do something pretty special over the next few kilometres if he wants to pull the pink jersey as leader of the Giro d'Italia onto his shoulders.
Well, Tonkov over the years has been a man of the Giro. He knows what it's like to wear the Maglie Rosa. He knows what it's like, in fact, to win the event. And so he's not going to give up easy. Just 1 kilometre to go of what the riders claim is the toughest stage of this year's race. There will be a change in leadership. It's only a question of will it go from Azzurra to Tonkov or from Azzurra to Pantani.
And Azzurra looking very difficult there. Guerini's taking the advantage here over Pantani, who's trying to get onto his back wheel.
So Guerini gets the result, and that's a great result. Pantani content with second. The clock starts now, and we wait to see whether the jersey goes to Pantani or Tonkov. But I think that Guerini will be a top four contender after that ride today. And this is the rest of the race coming in. Kepi Gonzalez, one by one, they're just going to drift in. 2:02 to Tonkov, so he will not get the pink jersey. It will go to Pantani, providing that Azzurra has not made some form of miraculous descent and has pinched back a little bit of time. There's Camazin at 2:16 down. He'll get the fifth place finish, by the way. And thankfully, we haven't had to go quite that high in the race today, which is probably as well for everybody, except Pantani. Here comes Azzurra now. The clock says it all. He's out of the pink jersey. He's lost it again. He lost it to Gonchar, and then he lost it to Laurent Roux, and now he's going to lose it to Marco Pantani. The time gaps are big, but not too big with the time trial still to come. 4:36 the gap. And on the stage now, what a comeback after those horrible years of his major injury when he was thought he would never walk again, never mind ride a bike. Marco Pantani now leads the Giro d'Italia. A magnificent performance by Il Pirato. He's won a stage in the race. He finished second today. He probably let Guerini get that one. He was happy enough to live in the hope that he would pull on at the Maglia Rosa. Fantastic.
For the first time in his career, he puts the Maglia Rosa onto his shoulders, and he certainly is going to appreciate that, because there are still some very more difficult stages to come, and he doesn't have a major advantage over Pavel Tonkov. You can see, Phil, only 30 seconds and 31 seconds to Guerini, who really made the operation of the day, and Alex Azzurra dropping down into fourth place, 1 minute and 1 second behind, still not too far back.
And the arrival of Oscar Camazin now, he's up into fifth place. So this tour is not finished yet. There's still a lot to come. And in fact, 5 more days, the penultimate day, will be the final time trial. Alex Azzurra has not lost that much time. He must hang on today, and the course taking the riders to an uphill finish, so it is a tough finish for the field. And Paul, 162 at the start, only 97 left to face up to what is a short stage today to Pampiago.
It certainly is, just 115 kilometres as Kepi Gonzalez has gone out very early on the attack to try and get himself some points in the King of the Mountains competition, which is currently still being led by Marco Pantani, but the jersey for the moment on the shoulders of Gonzalez.
Well, only because Pantani be too warm wearing two jerseys. He's got the pink jersey of race leader for the first time in his career. Makes him absolutely delighted. He's in his own terrain here. Everything going well for him today. Hasn't had any problems whatsoever. And as you can see, riding there in the immediate chase group.
Very difficult stage today, though, Phil, because in the last 45 kilometres, there are 3 major climbs. The first one is the San Floriano, followed by the Passa di Lavazze, and then the finishing climb up to the Alpe di Pampiago is 9 kilometres long, but at points, up to 20%.
Well, Well, the man blazing a trail here and looking set to pick up the lead in the King of the Mountains if he keeps up. This is Kepi Gonzalez, who won this championship a year ago. But Pantani also scoring points and not too far behind him. Overall, Pantani had 55 points today at the start, which was 22 more than Gonzalez.
Well, Gonzalez got to do something very special, but look at this. The man in the pink today, not giving very much away at all, goes over the top of that climb, 36 seconds behind, but in second place to keep maximum points in his back pocket and not let Kepi Gonzalez run away with this competition.
So he's looking forward to the double here, but there's still the finishing climb, which also counts for the King of the Mountains, and it is a very hard climb indeed. One has to say it's very much the climb for Pantani, but first of all, they've got to get up with this rider who's just topped over the Lavazzi. And here he is at 20 kilometres to go and still away.
Well, Kepi Gonzalez put an awful lot of effort into building up that lead, but it's only really hovered around the 45-second margin, and you can see in the group behind, all the major heads of states are there. Marco Pantani feeling very comfortable now in that pink jersey, which he's wearing for the first time on the roads of the Tour of Italy. Just 20 kilometres remaining, but look at what's in front of them. That very tough climb up to 1,750 metres, and still Gonzalez's lead hovering at 30 seconds.
Which isn't very much at all, is it? And not with the climb to come, although Gonzalez is a great climber, but he must be feeling a little bit tired now after his day out in the mountains. And every time he wins the points, Pantani snatches second best, which is a bit disconcerting for him. He may not even know it, of course. Anyway, Pantani's got his boys back up to the front again to try and lift the pace being set at the moment here by Podenzana, I think it is, and also behind him, Garzelli.
It certainly is. Podenzana, one of the oldest riders in the Tour of Italy, at 36 years of age, a former champion of Italy, now really one of the great riders on the Mercatone Uno squad, working very hard indeed for Marco Pantani.
Oops-a-daisy, looks like the legs decided to call it quits as the Mercatone Uno boys go past Kepi Gonzalez and put him back in the bunch. You're never going to defend a 30-second lead as you're heading up to the final climb. Alex Zula looking reasonably comfortable today. He's got his teammates around him here looking after him. Armin Meyer is up in front. They're all riding on the back wheel of the Mercatone Uno boys because, of course, when you have the leader on your team, then you're expected to do all of the pacemaking.
Well, they're coming now towards the town of Tesero, and that indicates the bottom of the climb, and it's 8.9 kilometres to go to the finish from there. And I think sporting a new haircut, Paolo Bettini there has shaved his head to try and make it as light as possible because he's going to have some hard times over the next couple of days.
And that reminds me, Paul, Michele Bartoli, by the way, was eliminated yesterday outside the time limit along with the sprinter Martinello and quite a few other riders. So Bartoli has gone, a leader of the Tour in the opening week.
Certainly have to call that rider enigmatic. One minute he's up and the next minute he's completely down. But when he's up, he certainly is one of the best riders in the world. Now, an attack coming here from Kamenzin. So it's interesting to note that Kamenzin has gone clear with the rider who, in the past, really has been shackled a little bit by the fact that Michele Bartoli was his team leader, Paolo Bettini. So these two guys have a 15-second advantage over the main group, now being led by the Festina squad.
And Kamenzin up to fifth overall in this race, but 4 minutes 13 off the jersey. He's actually developing into being a very good stage race rider, Oscar Kamenzin. There he is, champion of Switzerland.
Kamenzin turned professional at a very late age, but certainly has slipped into the role of being a good climber quite quickly indeed, and a big ally to have for Pavel Tonkov. Again, the Mappe boys are putting Kamenzin up to the front of the race there to have somebody to leapfrog Tonkov off if Tonkov couldn't get away from the leader of the race. But it's going to be very difficult because Marco Pantani wants to do all of the work himself.
Well, that's typical, and I say if he starts to build up his rhythm again, then he's going to find very few left by the summit. At the moment, he's got Tonkov and Zula for company, his two arch rivals, I think, for final victory in the finish in Milan.
This is certainly a great kind of finish for Marco Pantani, a very steep climb. There are sections where it tips up to 20%, and one of the steepest parts of the climb is right up in the last kilometre. So that is certainly where Marco Pantani will try and put the hammer down. But Kepi Gonzalez, too, in the latter part of this Giro d'Italia, is riding himself into great climbing form. And Pavel Tonkov and Alex Zula just have to sit there and keep an eye on the climbers and make sure they don't lose too much terrain.
Fabian Jecker, teammate of Zula, is just behind him to keep an eye on as best he can for as long as he can. 5 kilometres to go. Kamenzin looks as though he might be alone. Bettini may... Oh, no, he's got company. And the whole group has come up. So I'm just wondering if Bettini is still ahead.
Bettini.
No, he's on the back.
Bettini may well have been picked up by the rest of the group there because he's sitting right on the back there. Kamen's in, put a great effort in to try and get clear, but now Kepi Gonzalez feels that he's got a chance of getting himself a stage victory. He's been pushing and looking over the last few days to try and do something special, but Pantani realizes this is the climb for him. It's a great kind of finale, the kind that he really does like.
Well, seven riders clear here. This field once again is spread over many, many minutes as they make their way up towards the summit of the last climb of the day, and the finishing line awaits them. Now everybody is waiting for the expected acceleration from Marco Pantani, and is he building up for it right now? Certainly Tonkoff is marking him, so too is Zulla, then comes Kamazin, and that is the order as they go down. Ghiorini is there as well.
Well, this certainly couldn't suit him better, because over the last 5 kilometres, this climb goes from 13% to 15% to 20% in the last kilometre of the event. But Marco Pantani's putting an awful lot of effort into this, and he's trying now just to ride the other contenders off his wheel, and that's not the right way to go about winning a stage like this, because all that Tonkoff has to do is sit on the wheel of the Italian.
Well, there's massive cheers again for Pantani. He's never afraid to work. He knows it is his tempo and his rhythm which breaks the riders. They're frightened now to go near this man when he's on his own playground. Tonkoff is a very shrewd tactician. He's now sticking as close as he can. Ghiorini sensing the group is fading and crossing the gap.
And once again, Alex Zulla can't follow the acceleration of Marco Pantani, but neither too, I don't think, can Ghiorini. He's trying to get across there, but the man who's read the move and read the accelerations today is Pavel Tonkoff, very comfortably sitting on the wheel of Marco Pantani. He realizes he started the day off 30 seconds behind Pantani in the overall standings, and he now must not let this little Italian take any more advantage, because with the time trial still to come, the advantage is certainly in Tonkoff's court.
And the name of Zaina on the road there. Well, he's abandoned today. Velo, as far as I know, is still in. But this leading group is trying to make contact now with these two riders at the front. Tonkoff will not assist Pantani, but he will try and jump in before the finish, I'm sure, if he can survive on the final slopes.
What a great day for the first day in the pink jersey for Marco Pantani to be riding at the front of the Giro d'Italia. There, the man who started the action very early on, Oscar Kamenzind, is accompanying Alex Zulla, who's slipping away from the leaders once again on the slopes of this Giro d'Italia.
So Pavel Tonkoff sitting there nicely. Finished second last year in the Tour. The gap stretched now to the Zulla-Kamazin tandem to 31 seconds. And, you know, Tonkoff over the years has won 26 races. And you can add to that the general classification of the Settimana Bergamasca this year, where he also won two stages. So after injury, Paul, this year, he's come back good. His form is arriving absolutely on schedule. And it looks like he's going to provide Pantani, because in the time trial, in theory, the last time trial, it should go advantage towards Tonkoff.
Certainly, if Marco Pantani wants to win this Giro d'Italia, he's going to get himself a lot more time over Pavel Tonkoff, because he lost around about 2 minutes to him in the first time trial over 40 kilometres. And Tonkoff, I think, has come to form just at the right time, because the Settimana Bergamasca was just before this race, just a couple of weeks ago. So Tonkoff, for the first time, showing any signs of form as he built up for this event.
And he's actually manoeuvred Tonkoff into the lead now as we continue on the steep climb. Not something Pantani does too much of. Now he's either using his head a little bit or he is feeling the pace, and he's not climbing as well as he normally does. And the crowd there still raising a little bit of encouragement for him, to say the least, and there's some pretty fit spectators down there.
They certainly love Marco Pantani, but the day after he took the pink jersey in this event, he will be a little bit tired, because last night he will have had to go to the press room, and he will have stayed up very late indeed talking to journalists, explaining what it's like to have the pink jersey at the Tour of Italy. And that may well be why he's pushed himself back into second position here, because Tonkoff is a very strong rider here, finding his form in the last few days of the Giro d'Italia, and not looking like a weak man here, a big, powerful rider capable of pushing a massive gear on these climbs.
Well, today doesn't see the end of the mountains, and there's 4 days left in the Giro d'Italia. It has been an extraordinary race this year. If Pantani can survive to win it, the crowd will go absolutely berserk in Milan. But, you know, he's not climbing as well, and I think Paul's got the answer there. 600 metres to go to the finish now, and Tonkoff is looking good. Pantani's had a stage win. He finished second on a mountain stage to Ghiorini. He might well have to allow Tonkoff to take the line this time out, but at least he knows he's increasing his overall overall lead over everybody else.
He also has to be careful as well, because there are bonus seconds still on the finish line here, and Pantani seems to be suffering to stay on the back wheel of Tonkov because he keeps consistently getting out of the saddle, trying to keep the pace up as they get closer to the finish. It's Tonkov winding it up.
Ooh, and look at the face on Pantani. He's determined to hang on to his wheel because the timekeepers will split time riders on a mountaintop finish, so he wants no gap between that wheel. But I think there's going to be at least a 1 second gap as Tonkov comes away and gets his stage win. So the winner of 2 years ago, the second man last year, gets the victory in Pavel Tonkov. And for the rest, though, they are losing time to Marco Pantani.
Well, a great ride here, in fact, by Nicola Michele, who's coming up to the finish, because I've never seen him for the whole of this afternoon stage, and all of a sudden he's popped away to get himself a very nice third place. Thank you very much. He's just over half a minute outside the two leaders.
Well, he must have got round Alex Zülle somewhere. Our cameras didn't find him, but there is Zülle coming home in fourth place, and he's going to be the best part of a minute conceded. And that's another minute with the time trial still to come. So Zülle is losing his grip on this race, I think, while Pantani keeps nibbling away. Zülle is in. They say 56 seconds there. And this is Giuseppe Guerini. He's going to be outside at 1 minute, but should hang on to his top three placings. And so the first five riders are home. An extraordinary race again. There's the confirmation of the result. In fact, Zülle 58 seconds, Guerini at 107. Kamazin coming home in sixth place. Bettini, they're all familiar names for us now. And the overall now, 27 seconds to Pavel Tonkov. That is not much. Guerini at 147, Zülle out to 208. So Zülle is looking less likely to win this tour. But what about Pavel Tonkov? And so to the last day in the Dolomites, 19 stays from Cavallese to Plan di Monte Campioni. And now 239 kilometres. It's a long, long stage today. Zülle chatting away with his Swiss countryman there, Kamazin, still finding time to smile, but I think Paulie's lost this tour now.
I think he realises now that he won't be able to pull back that amount of time on a man like Marco Pantani in the mountains. And I don't think he'll be able to pull back that amount of time in the final time trial either, because he really has to do something very special to try and pull back 2.5 minutes on a man like Marco Pantani. And there's still a very tough finish to go, and he hasn't been able to match him on the mountaintop finishes. And today the climb up to Plan di Monte Campione is a very difficult one indeed.
Well, here's an early attacker here making his way in Niklas Axelsson, who's a Swedish rider on the Skriniar team. We've hardly seen a Skriniar rider on the attack this year.
Axelsson finished third overall in the Tour of Langkawi in the earlier this year in February. A very good rider indeed. The Skriniar team had an awful lot of success there, and they hoped that that would lay the foundations for what was going to be a very good Tour of Italy for them, but it certainly hasn't been a great one. But Axelsson now trying to wave the flag for his team with a 3.5 minute advantage over the chasing group, which it seems has been reduced quite rapidly.
Let's see, 3, 6, 9, maybe 10 or so riders here in this group. Pantani, maybe a few more now they've come into the picture. Pantani is down there. So too is Kamazin, easy to spot. Also Zülle, I think, was there. And Pavel Tonkov, but we'll wait for confirmation of that. Here is Pavel Tonkov. This is Gianni Bugno here.
Well, that's amazing. We haven't seen Bugno for a few days either. Bugno obviously riding himself into form in the latter part of this Giro d'Italia. A great competitor and a former fantastic champion, and it would be good to see him get a stage victory before the end of this Tour of Italy, because he certainly, I feel, will be retiring at the end of this year.
Yes, he certainly will. He's already announced this will be his last season, but there's the position over the top. Axelsson ahead of Kepi and Gonzalez and Piccoli up there. So Gonzalez still trying to nibble away at the King of the Mountains lead of Marco Pantani, but I think time also has run out for that.
It's also running out as well for Luc Leblanc, sitting at the back of the group here, just hoping to survive for the next few days. Not been a great Tour of Italy for Luc Leblanc, but it certainly has for his teammates.
Well, there's the holder of the pink jersey of the Intergiro, Mariano Piccoli, who always seems to win something in the Giro d'Italia. He has been a couple of times the King of the Mountains, and you remember that magic first week he had here when he wasn't too far away from picking up the Maglia Rosa. Anyway, Axelsson is still clear, but only by 78 seconds now.
Well, he's trying to survive here, but it's an awful long ride along the valley road before they get to the bottom of the final climb of the day, the Plan di Monte Campione. It's going to be a very difficult climb as well, because I'm sure Marco Pantani realises now that he's got to try and open up a few more seconds over Pavel Tonkov and Alex Zülle if he wants to win this year's Giro d'Italia.
Well, Marco Velo making light work of the chase here on behalf of his teammates. Now, these riders are closer to the leader. They're 45 seconds down at the last check. And number eight down there is Salvadelli from the Seiko team, which is becoming a pretty much of a headless team these days. In fact, they've surrendered, and they're going back into the Maglia Rosa group.
And the reason for that, Phil, is because there's two teams working very hard together at the moment, Mercatone Uno and the squad of Mapei, because Alex Zullo is a long way behind, 8 minutes and 20 seconds, so he must have blown up.
I think he's hit the wall big time. He's completely been dropped. They've been reporting he's been dropped, and now we've got confirmation over 8 minutes down. He's falling right away at the moment from a top six position overall, and Pantani won't be too concerned about that, and neither will Pavel Tonkov. The race now for sure is between these two riders, and Tonkov must hang on to Pantani. Then he's going to have a real shot at him in the time trial.
And that really makes the race by Axelsen here almost secondary, because these two riders we're looking at in the white jersey of the Mapei squad and the pink jersey of the leader of the Giro d'Italia is going to be a real duel between those two riders on the final climb of the day.
Well, it's been a good ride by the Skriniar rider, and I think the sort of indication there is he's been told to get out and do something and get themselves on television, because we haven't seen too much of the team at all at the moment. This is Gianni Bugno, and he's again trying to help his team leader. What a marvellous man he is.
What a star. The American riders on the Motorola squad used to call him Johnny Bugno, but he really is a great character and a tough rider, and never worried at all about doing a lot of work at the front of the main field. And he's working alongside Mercatone Uno, but these two guys locked in an incredible psychological battle, Marco Pantani and the man who wants to dethrone him, Pavel Tonkov.
And Camazin still there and certain to climb up a little bit too, and Ghiorini is also there trying to claim a podium place, so there's an in-battle going on there as well. Camazin's the one slightly disadvantaged, the time gap's a bit bigger back to him.
Podenzana on the front there, setting the tempo, keeping the pressure very much on in the Maglia Rosa group here, and you can see the riders at the back certainly are starting to suffer an awful lot there as we look now at Nicola Michelli, who's riding very well to stay in with this group, a great performer in this year's Giro d'Italia. But it's amazing how hard a domestique can work. And there's an attack by Pantani, and there's still an awful long way to go.
Well, he accelerated back past his teammate Podenzana. Tonkov spotted it straight away and has gone for him. Takes a lot of terrific guts to go for Pantani when he gets that magic acceleration. But Pantani has gone and Tonkov has joined him. So the tandem is in action again. Yesterday they held on to the finish and it was Tonkov who got the stage. But now Pantani knows, as he says goodbye to his favourite terrain, he's got to get a gap between himself and between Tonkov.
Well, in the last 5 kilometres, this climb does get very steep. It goes up to 21.5% with around about 4 kilometres remaining. And the last 1.5 kilometres are 23.5%. So if Pantani's going to do something special, he must do it on that section. There's Podenzana on the front. There's just a small gap, enough for Pantani to go through there. He goes into the corner and accelerates away. But just goes to show, Phil, how alert Tonkov is, because he wasn't going to let that one go.
No, he wasn't, and he was straight out of the saddle as soon as it happened. Off goes the hat now, and it's down to business here. We are looking at what the whole of the Giro d'Italia has been about these last few days. One of these riders will win this race, that's for sure, and they're not going to reveal the secret as to whom until we get to the finish in Milan.
Well, with 27 seconds advantage over Tonkov at the moment, that is certainly not enough for Marco Pantani to have confidence going into the final time trial, because that is where Pavel Tonkov has the advantage over the slightly built climber Pantani. But Pantani, as he goes under the banner, showing him 15 kilometres still remaining of this climb, is looking very confident indeed. And he never once asks for Tonkov to come to the front. In fact, he's trying to do that now, but Tonkov will not help.
He just takes a look at him. He slowed the pace down. Tonkov not worried, he knows if he can hold this sort of time gap on Pantani, the time trial could swing this race in his favour. Ghiorini is now chasing on the slopes behind, so he could come up if they slow down, because it was only 2 days ago after his great ride over the Marmolada that Ghiorini said he believed he could win this race. And you know, well, why not? Here he is, he's only 40 seconds back.
40 seconds is a long way on a climb like this, and those two riders at the front are riding very well indeed. Tonkov won't let Pantani go into second position here at all, because he realises if he lets the Italian go behind him, he cannot respond to the incessant attacks and changes of rhythm that Marco Pantani is capable of.
Well, the one man they've seriously damaged today, Alex Zullo, is now more than 10 minutes back and losing endless time apparently. He's really struggling to see the end of this stage. We've no cameras back there, you'll have to take my word on it. But Zuller is now going to be out of the top 12 overall if the time checks are real. And I think they are.
I have to say, Phil, I think Zuller underestimated the Tour of Italy. He came here with his team and they were very dominant in the first few days of this Giro d'Italia, and he's used too much of his effort. He's overspent on his forces, and I think now in the last few days he's starting to pay for them.
Well, Pantani has been so strong in the mountains, but he still hasn't got that final kick to his form that will distance Tonkov. And Tonkov, I think, knows this, and he seems to believe he's capable of hanging on to him. You see, Pantani wants help, and he doesn't normally ask for it.
A bit of panic there. He really is worried about Tonkov because he realises he couldn't get rid of Tonkov the previous day on a very tough climb like this, and he's tried to get him to come to the front now, forcing Tonkov now to set the pace. But if you look at the pedalling action of Tonkov there, it wasn't very tough. Pantani here looking across here, almost slowing to a stop, indicating to Tonkov, come on, play the fellow rider here and come to the front. And that is why we should work together, because we can get rid of all the other adversaries.
A shake of the head by Tonkov. I've seen that a couple of times, and I think he's admitted he can't deliver the killer blow here today. He can't rid himself of Tonkov. And Tonkov is close, and close indeed for the time trial. 10 kilometres from the summit, and still they are together. Back in the lead there was Marco Pantani as we go a bit further down. Still doing a great ride. One of the Scrigno riders is a different one now, Francesco Secchiari, who is coming up in that chase group. Not too sure where he is on the course at the moment.
And alongside him was Clavero of the Vitalico Seguros team. And trying to get into the action, stuck in the middle in no man's land, is Guerini. He's looking to try and see if he can see the back of the cars that are following the two leaders on the road, Tonkov and Pantani. And he's digging very deep indeed. He's third in the overall standings right now, 1 minute 47 seconds behind Marco Pantani. But those two riders up the road are going to be very difficult indeed to pull back.
Yeah, the gap is over. Opening, and Secchiari and Clavero, they'll be riding in fourth and fifth places on the road now. So Camazin is somewhere behind them, so he must be obviously losing time to these two leaders, although he is gaining it over Alex Zuller, who's now reportedly more than 30 minutes behind.
We're coming up to 7 kilometres to go to the summit of the climb, and they're now approaching the easier section of the climb where it levels out to around about 5%, but very shortly it will kick up towards the finish line and we'll see percentages well in excess of 20%, and that is where Marco Pantani is going to have to deliver the blow, if he can, to Pavel Tonkov.
Well, we've got a clock running here on the screen, so the television director will hopefully stop it at the right place and we'll see what the gap is. 9.2% is now the gradient here, 1 in 10. And Pantani still can't find the little acceleration he requires, just a half a mile an hour quicker to rid himself of Tonkov. Guerini continues to ride clear of the field in third place. He really did show now, or does show now rather, that his place in the Tour last year of third was no fluke.
Certainly wasn't. Daniel Clavero, Vitalico Seguros in second position here, but the big battle is further up the slopes as Pavel Tonkov feels very comfortable sitting in second position here behind the man who's leading the race, Marco Pantani. 1:22 now is the time gap to Guerini, who's a lot further down the climb. 3 kilometres to go to the summit for him, and a very long and hard summit. And there's the first chink of pain starting to appear in Tonkov, an acceleration coming from Pantani, but still he can't get rid of Tonkov, Phil.
He can't. He keeps on trying. Tonkov, though, I think has cracked. He's got the signs of it. And this is a last gasp effort by Marco Pantani. You know, the seconds he gains if he stays away to the finish could win in the Tour here over Tonkov, because he needs more time before that last time trial, and he knows it. And this is his final hope of getting any more time.
It's the last big chance to try and increase the buffer between himself and Pavel Tonkov. Tonkov really has blown away there. It's only about 12 seconds at the moment as they go around that corner. But this is the attack. Once again, he attacked him two or three times, and each time Tonkov was able to respond, able to come back up to the wheel, and then this time he just sat down and could not go anymore.
Well, for the moment I thought it was not a problem, and then all of a sudden Pavel Tonkov just hit the wall, sat up, and it was all over. And now Pantani, once he knows he's got him, he's going to go even faster. Now Tonkov is still a long way clear of Guerini and Secchiari and Clavero. They are now minutes behind. Guerini is over 2 minutes back of him, and Secchiari is a further minute on top of that. So they're not going to catch Tonkov, providing he just keeps his steady cool here.
Well, after 19 stages, 240 kilometres this morning, and this final few metres of this climb at an average of almost 1 in 4, 23.5%, and Marco Pantani makes it look so easy. He just gets out of the saddle and keeps digging away, and he's looking for that banner there, showing him that there's just 1 kilometre left to go to the finish, and he will sprint with all of his might to try and get a few extra seconds over Tonkov.
Absolutely, as he makes his way up towards the finishing line now. Pavel Tonkov, just over 1,000 metres to go towards the finish. He won't climb this in a minute and 12 seconds, though, even if he is Pantani. It'll take him a bit longer than that, but the more time he's out there, I think the more time he's going to gain now.
Well, it was 27 seconds, the advantage that Pantani had this morning, and this afternoon is certainly going to be a few more than that. And Pantani now knows this climb. He's been out here training. He knows exactly what the final few corners are like, and they're very steep indeed as he picks his way around. And Tonkov, looking further down the slopes, Phil, looks like a man who really is losing big time. 25 seconds and the clock is still ticking.
The clock is still ticking. That's the way it stopped at turn. Oh, it hasn't. It's still going, in fact. And Pantani is pulling away at the kilometre to go. This is going to be close to a minute on the line with 1,000 metres left to go up. Here's the 1 kilometre sign, and he goes through there about now, 42 seconds. So Paulie's going to concede almost a minute after hanging on for so long today. Pantani is getting a big gain here.
Well, that's the advantage of being a pure climber, to be able to explode like that in the last 2 or 3 kilometres of a mountain like this. And this is the steepest part of the climb. We're over 23%. And look at Pantani go. He's got the perfect gear. He's getting out of the saddle when he needs to. Sits down in the corners to go around there nice and smoothly. And once again, when it opens up, he's out of the saddle, accelerating, making the most of the gears as he can do now. And further down the slopes, he's opening up major time on Pavel Tonkov.
Well, this is a fine show of defiance now by Marco Pantani. He knew he had to win today to make sure that he took some big lead into the time trial tomorrow. And he's still dancing up this climb now. He's had a stage win already. He's, of course, got for the first time the Maglia Rosa. Now he's got a second stage win. Look at the time, almost 8 hours in the saddle today. Now you'll see the damage done. And we've heard rumours that Zülle is more than half an hour behind today. He's lost so much time now. Here comes Pavel Tonkov up to the line, almost a minute, 55 seconds they say on the line. This will be Ghiorini, who holds on to his top three places overall. The top three overall in the Tour have just crossed the line now. The double arm salute from Marco Pantani, who now makes himself look a little bit more realistic in that leader's jersey, winning today by 57 seconds, Ghiorini, Sequiaro, Clavero and Di Palo in that order. The big loser, though, there's no doubt about that, it was Alex Zülle today. His Tour took a big, big blow. Well, we're getting down to the closing stages. Tomorrow it is the final time trial. Now it's stage number 20. And this really shouldn't be too much of a threat for the leaders of the Tour. From Vario Terme to Mendrisio, 137 or so kilometres. And the overall lead for Pantani, a minute and 28 seconds. Ghiorini at 5:11. Alex Zülle is now 14th, and he is 32 minutes and 24 seconds down. And there's a little bit of a few extra names for you to look at. Oskar Kamerzin is fourth, and those four clear of the field, really. Michele has ridden a great Tour to come into the fifth place slot, and Bettini has always been an ever-present, but he's still a long way down, isn't he, at more than 19 minutes. So, Pantani today, his job simple, to keep an eye on Tonkov, and then see if 1 minute 28 seconds is enough for him to take this Tour out in the time trial tomorrow. And a lot of people will tell you they don't think so.
Well, it works out at around about 3 seconds a kilometre that Tonkov has to pull back on Marco Pantani. And in the previous time trial, over 40 kilometres, he pulled back almost 2 minutes on Pantani. So it's going to be a very closely matched event going down to the very last penultimate time trial before we head down into Milano. And I would think that Marco Pantani is not feeling too confident with that advantage.
A little bit further down the classification, the Podenzana, twice a champion of Italy, is 11th. The grand old man always riding so well. Let's join the action now as we're getting through the race stage here. And 9 kilometres from the finish, in fact, we've got something like 15 to 20 riders in this breakaway. That's Di Pasquale looking over his shoulder for Amore Vita. Luca Shinto, there he is. He was winner of the Tour of Lankawi last year. over in Malaysia, and the rest of the group are pulling them all back. The main body of the race, with all the important riders, is a little bit off the pace today, and that's not surprising.
Certainly isn't surprising after that very difficult stage yesterday. And now taking up the lead for the ASIC squad is Alexander Scheffer, wearing number 24. He's managed to slip away from the rest of that group as well.
Well, Alexander Scheffer, a Kazakhstan rider, been around a while now, one of the first, he might even be the first rider ever to turn professional for Kazakhstan. As he now tries to slip away here, he was having a very good Tour de France last year. You may remember a rider disappearing under a hot dog stand in the time trial. Well, it was Alexander Scheffer.
Back in the main field, the race really being controlled by the Mercatone Uno squad of Marco Pantani. But they're not too worried, I don't think, by the composition of this leading group of riders as we head now down towards the finishing line in Mendrisio. Around about 8 kilometres left to go, and Alexander Scheffer has around about 100 metres over the rest of the group, which is at the moment being led by one or two riders trying to make sure that he doesn't steal a marge over them before the finish line.
Well, some names for you in this breakaway: Paolo Lanfranchi, Felice Puccini, Scheffer you've seen. David Rebellin's an interesting man in this breakaway. Vladimir Belli is a good rider. And Gabriella Colombo is in here. So too is Mariano Piccoli. Well, why wouldn't he be? He always seems to be in the moves. He's been very consistent this year.
So it's all back together again for Alexander Scheffer, and once again the attack coming this time. It's one of the riders from the Pulte squad has decided to go out there and try and steal some advantage before we get down to the finish line. And amazingly enough, it's Luc Leblanc, and I'm surprised they let him get into a group like this.
Well, I'm surprised because I didn't have his name in the list of frontrunners, but there he is, Luc Leblanc. He's no longer a contender for the overall. He's had his good days, but I'm afraid they've been outnumbered by the bad days as Luc Leblanc tries to get something out of his Giro d'Italia this year.
Strangely enough, I caught sight of Kepe Gonzalez in that group as well. So the team of Marco Pantani have let one or two dangerous riders get into this little group here, because in fact Daniel De Paoli, who is in that group, rode very well yesterday and moved himself up quite high in the overall rankings.
Well, these riders having come up in that little change towards the end of the last few kilometres we saw. This is the green jersey of Kepe Gonzalez, 16th overall, but he's over half an hour off the pace now. The gaps have opened. It's a two-man race for the finish in Milan. And the big prize money, almost £1 million, or $1.4 million US, the overall prize money of the Giro d'Italia this year.
And 150,000 of those dollars will go to the overall winner. And will it be Marco Pantani or Pavel Tonkov? That's a question we can only answer tomorrow night, I reckon, Phil, after that very difficult time trial on the way down to Lugano.
But last year's King of the Mountains still trying to get a stage win out of this, and on this little climb here, a lot of tired legs. Look at the spaces now between the wheels as the riders just grapple with whatever they can find in front of them, and that group is still quite large.
It certainly is, and there's a lot of Mercatone Uno riders on the front of the main squad, though, trying to make sure that those riders in the leading group don't get too much of an advantage, because they have to keep control over the race over the next couple of days, and it will be good for their morale as Roberto Conti goes to the front to keep the pressure on. But Kepi Gonzalez has read the race nicely here. There's a small climb, just around about 6 kilometres to go to the finish, which is where Gonzalez is just now, and he's trying to make sure that he can go over the top there with an advantage of 15 or 20 seconds, but it's still a long flat run to the finish.
Just past that 7 kilometre to go banner, and Kepi is just about to top that little climb, I think. There's a sharp right turn coming up now, and you know that he's a popular rider here in Italy. He never fails to have a go. He really became a superstar in this event last year. Very, very popular rider indeed in the Giro after last year's event. Everybody glad to see him back, but somebody's going to have a go after him now. And this looks to me as though it is Luc Leblanc again.
Luc Leblanc certainly looking for a stage victory in this Tour of Italy. He noticed the move there by Kepi Gonzalez, a great climber himself when he's on form, and he knows that if somebody gets away with 20 or 30 seconds over the top of this final climb, then that's it, it's all over by the shouting. But Michele Bartoli's old teammate here, Andrea Noe, the former wearer of the pink jerseys, decided, I too want to try and get another stage victory. Once you've had one, you want another.
Absolutely. I've lost track of Noah for the moment in the overall classification, but that's David Rebellin, who's also up here in this front group, and also right, he was a star of the Tour of Italy a couple of years ago when he held the lead, I think it was for 10 days, and that's when people started to recognise his name. At last he'd come good, former Olympic rider.
Mariano Piccoli looking very comfortable trying to cover the moves there. But look at this, Luc Leblanc is having a very hard time getting onto the back wheel of Kepi Gonzalez there. He's finally done it, but it just goes to show how well Kepi Gonzalez is going as he goes there past the banner, showing them just 6 kilometres or 4 miles left to go.
Well, it's not so far, is it? But they're a full flight here now. Gonzalez has showed his resistance. And Luke has come up, but I caught a glimpse of his face. That hurt Luc Leblanc to get across to Kepi. Now he's got across. He's not rushing straight by to carry on with the pacemaking. Instead, he's checking out the gains, and he's trying to find time for a little bit of deep breathing exercises before he goes again. Now he's going to try and hurt Kepi.
Before he came to the front, though, he looked over his shoulder just to see how far behind the rest of the group was, and they're around about 12 seconds, and the big pressure on the front is coming from the Bréchelat riders, and right behind the rider there in the Chiclamina jersey is riding exceptionally well. That's Piccoli. He's looking to try and make sure that he takes that jersey all the way to Milano.
So we've got a tandem here now, which is a Colombian French tandem on the roads of Italy at 5 kilometres from the finish. They've got a real chance here. Let's have a little look back. Oh, well, they're going pretty quick, and maybe they haven't got a real chance at all, but 5 kilometres is not that far from the line.
Well, Piccoli's got his teammate on the front there. He's given him the nod, saying, look, you know, I've been pretty close before. I've got this jersey on my shoulders. I need a couple more points, and I can take it all the way to Milan. Put the pressure on and make sure you pull these two guys back, because certainly they'll start to play around once they get towards the finish line, because Kepi Gonzalez is the kind of tactical rider who'll start to sit on the back wheel of Luc Leblanc once he can sense the chance of a victory. But Leblanc, keeping the pressure on the front here, starting to panic. Once a rider starts to look over his shoulder like that, Phil, yeah, it means he's losing confidence.
Well, he's lost a lot of time. His form hasn't really come through in this year's race. He had such bad luck in the Giro last year when he was definitely on a podium finish, but for that nasty crash, and he was lucky to even continue in the race for a day or two. There's the main field, main chase group, the champion of Italy, Gianni Farazin, riding for the MAPEI team. He's still in the thick of the fray. Sitting on his wheel is Alexander Scheffler, who's tried an attack. He's got a teammate here in Andrea Noah. As we look down the line of riders looking for the likely candidate to take this stage out, if they can pull back the two leaders.
Well, Alexander Scheffler's the kind of guy who can jump away in the final few metres of a race like this, a very fast finisher. Buenahora there, number 177, he's quietly slipped into the nice breakaways over the last couple of days. Surprising to see him taking part on an aggressive flat stage, because he's the kind of man we'd expect to see more of in the mountains. 4 kilometres remaining for the two leaders, and still their lead is very precarious indeed.
Through on the roundabout there. That's the right side if you live in Europe. It'd be the wrong side if you lived in Great Britain. As the riders now make the way towards the finish, you can forget any chance of the main chase coming in today, because they are a long way behind and have no interest in this breakaway today. It'll pan down just to see if one or two riders in the chase group have now got these two in their sights. But you know, Paul, with such a short distance to go, this is still looking good.
It's still looking very good indeed. But you've noticed now that Kepi Gonzalez has gone to the back for the last kilometre or so. He's forcing Luc Leblanc to do a lot of the work. And Leblanc is a very intelligent rider. He's been a pro for many years now. And he won't like the fact that Kepi Gonzalez has stopped contributing to the success of this breakaway. And shortly, I think these two guys are going to slow down a little bit, as Gonzalez has realised that Luc Leblanc's not going to carry him to the finish. And he has come over the top of the Frenchman to keep the pace high. But look at this, the gap is still hovering at 10 seconds.
There's 16 riders in that chase down there, and there's about half of them committed to catch the two leaders. And it's going to be a tough chase, but they might just about get them. You know, the chasers have a nasty habit of timing everything to perfection. How about the last 500 metres at the moment? Because it's looking that way, isn't it?
It certainly is. Gonzalez didn't look very comfortable on the back wheel of Luc Leblanc there. As they go around that corner, it's come down to around about 5 seconds, and it looks as if the Bréchelat rider on the front is certainly trying to set it up for Piccoli, who's currently sitting in second position. And the guy who's leading them out will push himself right into the depths of the red zone, because he realises that Piccoli has got a great chance of a victory here, because he knows now that he's in the ideal position as we get closer and closer to the finish. Leblanc has switched over to the left-hand side, and once again a panic move by Kepi Gonzalez, and Leblanc realising that it's almost all over, bar the shouting, because these two guys certainly haven't got the impetus left to hold off this group.
Well, he's raised his game again, Luc Leblanc. When he saw Kepi sprint through, he thought about it, but he went back to his back wheel. But it's not going to worry too much about it now, because it looks like the rider just behind him there is Mariano Piccoli, who's brought the whole lot back into the action. Piccoli's the rider in that nice mauve jersey. He's used his teammate to do the damage, Sgambaluri, who was second in the under-23 championships a couple of years ago.
Also moving up there, the Seiko Cannondale rider, Paolo Salvadelli as well. And in the main field, it's the yellow squad on the front, the squad of Marco Pantani, the leader of the race. And they're obviously not too worried about the situation up the road. All they want to do is to make sure they get Marco to the finish without any problems.
So Piccolo is just riding in second place. He's obviously told his young teammate to just keep the pace high now. He's really fancying a stage win. He's been so close so often and it hasn't come his way yet, and not since first stage, of course, when he nipped away and beat all the sprinters. But since then, he hasn't had the chance to win a game. And he hasn't been quite the climber he has been in the past in this race either. And, well, times change, of course, and now he's in a breakaway once more. And he should be in with a good chance here.
Salvadelli moving up into first place now, keeping the pace high. He's used to working like this because normally he would do it for Mario Cipollini. Moving up into fourth place there is David Rebellin and Gianmatteo Fanini in the blue jersey there, moving up into fifth place. And everybody now getting into the position for what is going to be a group sprint towards the finish line. And the group of Pantani is a fair way behind there. There's a little bit of leaning on the shoulders by Gianmatteo Fanini there. He realizes he wants to keep the wheel of Piccoli. He reckons he's the fastest guy in the group.
So Fanini is the leader, the blue jersey, the leader of the Intergiro competition, and that's what it means. And he's now got the leader of the points competition right in front of him, Piccoli. And there's going to be some valuable points scored today by the consistent finishers too, because they're both in this front group.
Salvadelli now up into second position, still Piccoli in third place there, happily sitting on the wheel of Salvadelli, the big lead-out man for Mario Cipollini normally, and Fanini moving up into third spot now. A little dodgy corner just before the finish line, and if you're not up there to the front now, then you're much too far behind.
Well, there's 18 men in the hat here now as we approach the finishing line. And again, the pace still being set here by Salvadelli, kept up nice and high. And look at the face of Fanini there, who's in third wheel. He knows that if he's going to win this, he's going to take on Piccoli. Piccoli just waiting and waiting and waiting because he's got a good finish. He's not a pure sprinter. Somebody's come down the outside here with a terrific rush just off our camera. And it's a Festina rider who's gone for it this time through. And it's going to be very, very tight, but that's belly, and it's all over because Fanini got through and he came off the wheel of Piccoli. And I'll tell you what, Fanini was the guy who was disqualified from the Tour last year after he was leading out Cipollini. He sat up and he blocked the rest of the race and he was thrown out of the Giro. Now his teammate Cipollini no longer in the race and Fanini no longer on the team either. And he's now taking a stage win for himself.
Well, it's been a long day in the saddle for Marco Pantani's Mercatone Uno boys, and they've really ridden like Trojans right at the front for the last 20 or 30 kilometres, setting the pace. All they have to do is just make sure that they can get Pantani to the finish, because for him tomorrow, it's all on his own. It's the individual time trial when he has to match himself against Pavel Tonkov.
So the former lead-out man, or the lead-out man for Cipollini, who's now out of the Tour, comes and takes over the role himself and gets an opportunist stage win there in the Giro d'Italia. So he's keeping Seiko's name on the headlines here in tomorrow morning's papers. And he watched right man too, Mario Piccoli, because Piccoli got second. The man that came with the rush, Vladimir Belli, hung on just off the edge of our cameras, I think, for third place. And Colombo got home in fourth, and David Rebellin, he was there in fifth place. That was the unofficial list over the line. But I have to say now, he gets rushed into the hut and gets ready for the presentation, while a long, thin line of riders are still some way out of town.
It's certainly been a tough day for these guys, and it's a long line, the main field, and you can see the speed is quite remarkable, but this is just how to time a sprint to perfection. Just coming through there, Fanini gets it, a full bike length ahead of Piccoli, who was certainly the man to watch, as you said, and that, I think, is how Gianmatteo Fanini based his sprint. He wanted to get onto the wheel of Piccoli, and when it came to the line, he just opened up the gas, and he certainly had the power to do it, because up through the middle, Belli tried to surprise them, but he didn't have enough power just to keep it going.
So Piccoli, second place for him. He's been so consistent, keeps his lead in that nice purple coloured jersey, I suppose you call it, or cyclamen. And here comes the blue jersey of the Intergiro leader, and Gianmatteo Fanini gets the stage victory, free as a bird, without his team captain Mario Cipollini to interrupt. Cipollini would like that finish. So the teammates of Marco Pantani, fairly routine day for them today. They've done their job well to try and get their man to the finishing line as fresh as possible. Tomorrow it is big showdown time in the penultimate time trial over 34 kilometres. It's not that long, 34 kilometres, and you know, Marco now is going to feel that he won't lose all of the time that he's made over Pavel Tonkov, but he does need a fairly easy ride. There's the stage winner for Seiko, Gian Matteo Fagnini. He gets the victory, he gets the champagne. And they're all pretty good at opening the bottles when it comes round to the winner's podium, aren't they? Oh, he's not going to give too much away. He's going to drink it all himself. Well done. So Mario Cipollini probably watched that on his television back home in Italy, and it's been a long escape. They're minutes ahead. And meanwhile, back out on the road, the Mercatone Uno boys are bringing Marco Pantani in. There's the sprint finish yet again for you on this big time gap. And that's how Fagnini saw the finish, took his chance and got the victory. Confirmation of the result, Piccoli, Belli, Colombo, all of these riders in the breakaway. There were 18 in the end in the breakaway. And Di Paolo getting the 10th place, all same time after only 3.5 hours racing today. So after over 3,600 kilometres, two men still in with a chance of winning the Giro d'Italia, and this is the penultimate rider to start, Pavel Tonkov, the winner 2 years ago. And he knows, even though he's very popular here in Italy, that all of the cheers will be reserved for the man who will start behind him. The course is over 34 kilometres between Mendrisio and Lugano.
I tell you, Phil, last night everybody was trying to work out the amount of time that Pavel Tonkov needed to take out for every kilometre, and looking back at all the previous time trials when they've come up against each other, all he really needs to do is pull back 3 seconds per kilometre on Marco Pantani, and that will give him the overall lead on the penultimate day this year of the Giro d'Italia. But he knows he has to go out and do that, and at the end of a race like the Tour of Italy, it's very difficult to come out and put in a special performance like this. But the course certainly does suit him. It's not very tough either. It's fairly flat with just a small climb towards the finish,
which I'm not so sure will favour Pantani. But remember, his gap is 1 minute 20, there it is for you, 1:28, over or under Pantani's time for the course so far. Ghirini, third overall, is over 5 minutes back and really doesn't matter now. He should easily confirm his third place on the podium for a second year. This man, though, was second last year. He won the year before. His record is tremendous in the years gone by. He knows he can still steal this race on the very, very last time trial.
And he's already off to a very good start. The position is perfect. He's right down on the center of those handlebars. He's opted for a full disc wheel at the rear of his machine and a tri-spoke on the front. An aerodynamic position for him and an aerodynamic machine. The man who really has to do something special, though, is the man here wearing the pink jersey, Marco Pantani. And he, too, is riding a fairly standard machine with a full disc at the rear.
Caught by Alex Zuller in the time trial almost 3 weeks ago. Well, certainly 2 weeks ago now. And dropping away from the leaderboard, he bounced back in the mountains. In fact, he destroyed everybody except Pavel Tonkov in the mountains. Alex Zula, well, he's already riding at the moment, not recording great times at the Czechs. He blew up towards the end of this race. Now, Pantani knows this is the only man that will spoil what for him will certainly be the finest day of his sporting career.
It's going to be a very nervous moment for Pantani as the seconds tick away for the very last time trial in this year's Tour of Italy, and he knows what times are going to be done out on the course by Pavel Tonkov. He will get that relayed back to him by his supporters at the side of the road, all cycling aficionados, and they will let him know exactly what's going on. Just looking at Tonkov's bike there, Phil, it looks very much to me as if he's opted for a 28-inch rear wheel there, which will give him a very large gear combination.
Well, it's all or nothing, I suppose. His second place overall is assured. He's not going to lose time, I wouldn't think, to Giuseppe Ghirini, but it's the first place he wants.
Listen to the crowd,
yes,
Phil. It's almost
fantastic.
Like a football match out there. They're all shouting for Pantani, the man they call Elefantino. They call him the Pirate. There are so many nicknames this man conjures up, and it's the last 4 seconds.
And he goes to an enormous cheer here now. 34 kilometres, all that separates him from that Maglia Rosa, because tomorrow on the ride into Milan, nobody will attack him. He's going to be like a man possessed. Look at the way he's looking at the road. He is going to rise to the occasion. You get that feeling.
Well, it's obviously what his plan is, to go out as quickly as possible and try and match over the first 4 or 5 kilometres. The time's being done out on the course by Pavel Tonkov. This man looks like a machine this afternoon. He's perfectly still on his body, and his bike is ticking over nicely. Pantani, on the other hand, does not look like a time trialist at all, but he's gone out quickly.
Well, look at this then. So Massimo Podenzana is setting the time for the rest to beat now, because he's just going to get inside Velo's time as he comes up to the line, only just 40.23. Well, this is Marco Pantani, and there are the times at the moment. Velo second, Serpellini's in third place, 31 seconds back. Alex Ulla finished, but he's already off the leaderboard and clearly no longer interested in the Giro d'Italia. But this man is, of course, head-to-head now with Pavel Tonkov. And the surprising thing is that, in fact, Tonkov is down at the moment, Paul, by a few seconds to Pantani.
Well, that's amazing. Obviously, what Pantani wanted to do was go out over the first 10 kilometres as quickly as possible and see if he can just hold the tempo that he's chosen. He's doing that very well at the moment, but there's still another 20 or so kilometers to go, and Tonkov to me looks perfect. He's pedaling like a metronome, 52.1 kilometers an hour. Everything seems to be perfect, but in fact Pantani, who doesn't look so good, is up on him on time,
but only by 2 seconds at the moment, so you could put a handkerchief across them on the road. Well, now the arrival of Sergei Gonchar, winner of the time trial stage last year. And now he's looking a little bit laboured, but his time is going to give him the rewards, I think. He's going to go onto the leaderboard.
The time to beat is that of Massimo Podenzana. Second is Marco Velo at the moment, and he is using a huge gear. The man who was very close to winning the time trial championships of the world last year in San Sebastian, looking for a stage victory here at the Tour of Italy.
So it's a long way up to the finishing line here. Gonchar, though, is labouring his way up and is hoping that he will take out another time trial stage in the Giro d'Italia. Podenzana is the man he's got to beat. He's in and he's got the best time. And Marco Velo is in second place at the moment. And Gonchar is making a meal of this, but it's a long, long, hard finishing straight. It's going to be all worthwhile. He's going to get inside Massimo's time. There's the line. And there's the time, 39.54, best time so far. Pantani is on a flyer here. And 1 minute 40, 1 minute 38. He's hovering 6 to 8 seconds, the advantage.
Well, there's the advantage that Marco Pantani has over Pavel Tonkov. So everybody's calculations from last night have gone right out of the window. It really has thrown a spanner in the works for the specialist, because Pantani is ahead of Pavel Tonkov on the road at the moment in the time trial. And he's going to be very happy with that performance.
Well, now let's see what Pavel Tonkov is doing here at the intermediate check. There's the best time, or second best time, of Podenzana. So, Paul, he's falling behind the time of Gonchar.
Falling behind Gonchar, and it looks as if he's going to fall behind the time of Podenzana, but it's around about the same time, 13 seconds faster. In fact, he's gone through in second place. Now, the next man to come up to this point is going to be Marco Pantani, and that will give us a good estimation of how the little Italian is riding.
That same time check across that lovely little fucking swimming pool down there. Sergei Gonchar still the best time. We've seen Tonkov go through with the second best time. Pantani is now, what's he going to do? Because he's still ahead of Tonkov's time as we approach that time check. This could be a turn up for the books here. 20.01 Tonkov went through. Whichever way you look at it, Pantani's on a great ride. He's the second best time, and there's no one else left to pass that point.
Well, 11 seconds is advantage over Pavel Tonkov at this stage of the game, and that is a remarkable performance. We're halfway through this time trial, and I would think Marco Pantani will be getting some very good information from his team manager, who's probably watching this live on TV.
Well, here he is, and he must be surprised if he knows, and I expect he does, Paul, but in fact, Pantani is inspired. Now we've got the double shot here. Marco Pantani's on the left, as if you need me to tell you.
Well, it's incredible to look at the difference in the style of these two riders. Pantani on the left, a very punchy style, not really a pure time trialist. On the right, Pavel Tonkov looks very good indeed, still in exactly the same position he had in the early part of this time trial, looking comfortable, still keeping the big gear rolling over, while on the other side, Marco Pantani's pedaling about 105 RPM.
and almost 51 kilometres an hour, in excess of 32 miles an hour. So don't anybody ever again say that Marco Pantani can't ride a time trial. I think he's doing the performance of his life here. He is not going to relinquish the pink jersey as leader. In fact, he's going to win this race in style, or at least beat Pavel Tonkov, even if he doesn't get the better of Sergei Gonchar.
Well, the clock there showing what the current overall standings are at the moment. The difference between these two riders is still hovering at 1 minute and 28 seconds. And in fact, that's exactly the time that it was this morning. So Pantani is losing a little bit of time over the in middle section of this time trial here. And Tonkov is coming back, an excellent time trialist. He's judging his ride properly, but for the moment, he's not eating into the advantage of Marco Pantani.
And that's what's important. The big effort here being made by Guerini. There's Alex Zülle, seventh best time, still in at the finish for him. And Guerini's going to fall behind Zülle's time, which I'm sure Alex will be disappointed with, but he never really tried today. He lost his chance of winning this race in the mountains. Guerini heads for the finish. Tonkov, still, it's a balancing act, Paul. They're locked together, both Tonkov and Pantani, almost the same time overall as when they set out.
It's amazing. It went to 11 seconds advantage to Marco Pantani. Now it's a balanced ride. But for Giuseppe Guerini, he's done the ride that he needed to make sure that he will climb onto the podium when we go into Milano tomorrow, because his ride today will give him third place overall in the Giro d'Italia this year.
Yeah, in fairness, there really was no big pressure on Guerini. Just a solid ride from him today is all that was required. Camazin was too far behind him, and Giuseppe comes in 14th place at the moment. Enormous crowds here now as they strain forward to see coming up towards the finish Pavel Tonkov. They will know from the Czechs on the road this has been a tremendous battle between the Russian and the Italian. Almost identical times out on the road. Gonchar is still best man in at the finish. Podenzana is the second place rider and Marco Velo is the third at the moment in the finish. Now Tonkov, I think, should get in amongst those, surely.
Well, once Tonkov comes across the line, these riders separated by 2 minutes on the road. The crowd won't have to wait very long till they know who is going to be the winner of the Giro d'Italia this year. But the style of Tonkov certainly hasn't changed at all, Phil, over the last few kilometres.
And he's not going to win, Paul, because he's heading for the time of Marco Velo in fourth place. Now it's Serpellini. Tonkov comes in only fourth. 40 minutes and 29 seconds. That's not a good ride for the Russian. Well, that means now that Marco Pantani, who's coming in towards the finish, can afford to cruise home in a time of 42 minutes and 7 seconds. And I don't think that's going to happen, Paul. There's no way now that Pantani's going to win the stage. He's been down on Gonchar, but he's going to get some terrific satisfaction. I think he's going to beat Tonkov.
Well, at the moment, the board there indicating that he's still got an advantage over Tonkov in this time trial here. Now hovering at 3 seconds, but a great ride by Marco Pantani with the pink jersey on his shoulders. That's the win at the moment. Gonchar is still leading ahead of Podenzana. And in fact, Marco Velo still holding on to third place in the overall standings. But the man really putting in the performance and matching Pavel Tonkov, the Russian, all the way to the line is Marco Pantani.
Just a few seconds separating the top four, but Tonkov, surprisingly enough, is fourth of those top four. As Pantani continues to run him close, and we think he's still nibbling away 1 or 2 seconds quicker than Tonkov. It's going to be desperately close. If this had been on a track, this would have been one of the finest pursuit races you will ever have seen. It has gone up and down in favour of the other all of the time. But I think what has made the big difference, Paul, is the fact that Pantani is proving to be unstoppable today, taking into account his history of injury, the fact he's Italian, the fact that he's going to win this race.
And the fact, I think, that Bianchi have invested an awful lot of money into providing a very good time trial machine for him. He's done a lot of studies on his position recently in the wind tunnel to try and make sure he's as aerodynamic as possible. And that machine, as he goes under the 1 kilometer banner of this time trial here, is perfectly matched to Marco Pantani, and he's matched Tonkov all the way to the line.
Well, you can see in the team car behind, they're all smiles. They know that they're looking at the winner of the Giro d'Italia, barring accidents tomorrow. Marco Pantani has pulled out of the bag the ride of his life against the watch. It's the moment of truth, yes, but it's also the moment of greatness of this man as he comes up towards the finishing line now. It's a considerable scalp to beat Tonkov, if that's what he does, or even get this close to him in a time trial, because Tonkov is recognised as a great time trial rider. But Pantani now heading up towards the line. The Italian flags can wave for sure now, because they are going to see an Italian winner tomorrow in Milan, all at the Giro d'Italia. The flotilla of motorbikes, The grimace on Pantani, he just wants to get it over with, but that grimace will turn to a smile in a minute. We are waiting now to see the clock come on our screen and tell us just how close to reality Pantani is.
Well, he really has blown all the experts out of the water today, Phil. Everyone was saying he was going to lose at least 2 seconds a kilometre, and look at that time. He's going very close to his teammates there. In fact, third place time for Marco Pantani, 2 places ahead of Pavel Tonkov, and the time doesn't really matter.
Even the police are applauding here because he has done what nobody thought was possible. For 24 hours, the so-called experts have worked out how much he would lose to Tonkov in the time trial. I bet nobody worked out how much he would gain, and that's exactly what he's done. And so the press are going to be delighted with the next half hour or so of interviews that Pantani will give. A little man with the bald head, the pirate, has delivered the goods today. He's in amongst them. He has finished right up in the time trial. It was Gonchar for the record, Podenzana, Pantani third, Marco Velo, his teammate, fourth. Marvellous day out for the boys from Mercatoni Uno. They'll win the team in this race as well. And Pavel Tonkov taking fifth, with Serpellini sixth, Kamazin seventh, and Zulla finishing only in ninth. Not the place for the world champion, but his incentive in this year's Giro has gone. And let's have a look at the overall. This will be pretty close to the final figures tomorrow now. Pantani has a 1 minute 33 seconds advantage. He's increased it over Pavel Tonkov. Guarini third for the second year in succession, but 6:51. Kamazin right in the slot at fourth, but 12 minutes plus down. Clavero coming in at fifth, and the champion of Italy there in sixth. And Gonchar now in the top 10 with his time trial performance today. And this is no way for Marco Pantani to win the Tour of Italy, is it? The rain is coming down here as the riders now heading into Milan after 173 kilometres and the final stage, stage 22. Paul, the judges have taken the decision to time the race only to the entrance to the circuit.
Well, that's because of the difficulty of actually racing around this circuit in these weather conditions, and I do believe the distance of this lap doesn't conform to the international racing governing bodies' distances for the end of a stage race. But look at that, as Rubiera goes through the puddles there, he really sprays up a lot of water, and a lot of riders taking risks to try and win the stage. But for Marco Pantani, the first time they went across the finishing line meant for him that the clock had stopped in this year's Giro d'Italia, so now he's just riding round for the pleasure and savouring the moments that he can show off that pink jersey to the crowd here in Milan.
Well, at the start of the week, let's not forget that Pantani crashed in weather conditions like this in the mountains. Since then, of course, he's built his lead. He's produced that extraordinary time trial to increase his lead. Now he just wants to keep out of trouble and get this race over and done with, and be the first Italian since Ivan Gotti, which is only a year, to win the Giro d'Italia.
José Luis Rubiera from the Kelme squad of Spain trying to get out there and steal a marge over the rest of the main field. And certainly still one or two of the sprinters left in with a chance of taking victory on the final stage here around the streets of Milan, but no more Mario Cipollini, the man who last year took out the points classification and was presented on the finishing podium in that magnificent white suit, for which, again, he got a magnificent fine for from the international governing body. It's a pity that Mario is not here at the moment, and I'm sure he's back at home taking a keen interest in this on the TV. But for the moment, Rubiera is out on the front trying to steal the show away from the sprinters.
Well, you see, just look at those road conditions now. They are not for the nervous at all. Those tram lines across the middle of the cobbles are absolutely deadly. You've got to meet them at right angles, otherwise you're down. And the rider's thinking more of self-preservation, I think, but you'll always get the kamikaze ones who'll want to go away and try and do something and try and get a stage win, especially in Milano, which is where all the Italians want to win.
Well, Rubiera's advantage there, 7 seconds over the man who was chasing, who was Marco Di Renzo from the Brescia squad. It's a very tenuous lead that he's got here, just hovering there as we go under the 1 kilometre banner, which shows just 1 kilometre remaining on the end of this very difficult stage.
Well, the riders remaining here in the race are just over 90, 94 to be exact. They're all not very far behind Rubiera at all. And I bet they're delighted too. The 13 scheduled laps here reduced to only 10, and the time already taken as we race into the last few hundred metres. And Paul, it looks as though Ribeiro is going to be caught almost in sight of the line. Nasty left-hander there.
It certainly is, followed by a nasty left-hander as well, and then he'll be into the finishing straight. But you can see the main field hot on his heels there, and a lot of riders trying to pull him back. There was the pink jersey of Marco Pantani, safely in the first 15 positions there. But Ribeiro is still hanging on to about 10 lengths advantage over the main field, but the sprint starting in earnest behind him.
Well, they'll have to start in earnest because he's almost to the line here, but Piccoli is trying to get on terms. I saw Strazza was still there, and Fagnini is also trying to get up on terms. He's not going to have the legs. Poor Ribeiro, you've got to feel sorry for him here as he goes for the line. And bursting through on the inside, and that blue jersey again is Fagnino. Is he going to get it? Win number two for the Seiko man. That would be the stage that Cipollini would always love to win. And it's gone to his teammate Gian Matteo Fagnini. He wins ahead of Massimo Strazza. But in the middle of the pack there, and happy to be at the finishing line, the pink jersey, and that's who the crowd have reserved their cheers for, of Marco Pantani. The big man, or the little man rather, has made a big return to the top cycle race in Italy, and he's won it so well with a brilliant time trial that left nobody in any doubt. The best man has won this year's tour, a tour which saw so many leaders when Zülle kept taking the lead back and in the end blew big time in the mountains, and finally didn't get anywhere near the winner's rostrum. So Marco Pantani, 101, will be converted next year to number one as a winner of the Giro d'Italia. And this, don't forget, was a great race this year, Paul.
The greatest performance was by Marco Pantani, because a few years ago people thought he would never even walk again, let alone ride a bike.